So here is the game. And level one, the idea is that everybody's safe in here. These two guys in red have to stay in the middle, and you just change the shape according to what you want to do. Wider, not very far front to back. I mean, there's no numbers, depends on your kids. But you want success, and here's the trick. Method of coaching again. These guys outnumber these guys. They've all got a ball. I let everybody go through it first. Round one, everybody gets a go, dribbling twice and then once in the middle. Then I ask them questions. When do you go? If you're doing this game, when do you think this guy should go to try and get to the other side? When should he do it? You can't answer, of course. Well, that's good because the picture says that, yeah. So well done for you. Yes, twice you've been on the money tonight, so that's great. So obviously one of the questions would be, why did you go when his back was to you, or turn it around and say, when would you go? So you're asking, and the reason is he's distracted or he's facing the other way. You ask the question, would you go fast or slow? What do you think, Paul? Most times?
Yeah.
Why?
So he doesn't see you coming. Go right by him.
Okay, so you've got some speed involved. Would you go in a dead straight line every time, do you think? Yeah. You've done this before anyway. No, you wouldn't go in a straight line, but you might go here, and you might go diagonally, and you might go there and cut back, zigzag. See what I'm getting at? So the whole point being that you're giving them ideas of how to do this successfully, and you want success. You're training them to be successful in this case. You're not training them to fail, which is why there's two against four and there's four balls. The next level of this, this is where it says you now have two balls, but somehow or other there's still four balls there. The point being, if you take away two balls, and with eight-year-olds, I might just do that for a while to try it. Because now you can pass, and you can dribble, and you've got another component. Passing and dribbling are both in there. Defending is in there, obviously. And then the third piece of it, to be honest, I actually, with the older kids, just so you know, it's a progression, and as you stay with your kids over a period of time, I can get to one ball, and it's now a 4-versus-2 game. It's not very complicated, but what I do is I stick one of these four attackers in the middle. And as soon as you do that, great things happen. Because it's like real soccer. So they can dribble, they can pass, they can get it back, they can play balls across the grid. Suddenly it's soccer breaks out, and there's a million versions of this. But I think it's fun, I just don't know that the last version for eight-year-olds will work for you until the end of a season. Then it might be chaos and you still want to try it. Okay? I call it warm-up game because I'm not very creative. Okay. Where's Nick? What were the words I gave you?
Think outside the box.
Think outside the box. What was the other one?
Animals.
Animals. Okay, take animals first. When we did the battleship game, and you have a sheet on that at the back, the traditional model is using, you know, there's some DVDs that are out there, and the USU Soccer is in the process of updating them, and we were giving them away to everybody. You could have all had one, but they're updating them. When we get them, Mark French will tell you when we get them. Point being, they use battleships as the standard model. I've also seen a million different versions of it. One of the more recent ones is to actually use animal sounds. So instead of a battleship, think of an animal that you can make a sound that would replace the battleship sound.
A dog bark.
How's that go? Pardon? Nobody heard you. Again?
Ruff.
So there's one version of a dog. Okay? Give me an animal. Different one.
Chicken.
I'm sure the psychologist, is there a psychologist in the room? Because I'm sure there'll be something comes out of this that's relevant. It's chicken, okay. And make the sound of a chicken. Okay. Pretty dynamic that. Not meaning, yeah, that's fine. But if you were a kid, you'd feel pretty good about coming up with that. So let's try somebody else who we haven't picked on tonight. Give me an animal.
A lion.
Interesting. I think the psychologists are really into it now. Big man, strong muscles. Lion, how would that go? See, we got a battleship type sound. You see what I'm getting at? Now, kids are inventive and they're going to... So once you've got a series of these, you also got... Who can think of a different one? So give me a different one.
Cow.
Okay. All right. How's that go?
Moo.
Okay. Good. Give me a different one.
Me?
Yeah.
Cat.
Okay. How's a cat go?
Meow.
Except when I take ours to the vet and then it's awful sound. The most awful sound. Yeah, okay, so there's another option there. You could go with animal sounds. You could say jungle animal sounds. You could say domestic animal sounds. And I'll promise you, as much as you say that really seems stupid, a lot of your kids are going to go, that's actually okay. It's no different from what they might do in school. Okay? So, other one was think outside the box. When I went to four goals at the end, you could say that's thinking outside the box because we've got a goal there and a goal there. So in other words, we're stretching people. They can't defend that little tiny goal and stand in front of it, yes? No success. By going this way, that's thinking outside the box. It's a good tool. Another one we did was to go to an end line as opposed to a goal. So crossing the line, which was 10 yards wide, is really quite straightforward. In other words, if you're doing anything that's creative, attacking, you want positive results, think outside the box. Give them something where it can be successful. When I put Matt as the neutral player, he makes the attacking team numbers up, which means they could be more successful. By giving him free rein, if you will, you can't take it off me, if I call for it, you've got to give it to me. He guarantees to be successful. What are you doing? You're teaching them basic fundamental things in the game without actually cheating on it. It's still real soccer. Okay? So think outside the box. Now, the last question was defending, was it? Where is he?
Yeah.
Defending. He asked me about when would I teach defending, how would I teach defending. Give me a little more embellishment of your thought. Hold up one sec. Let me quiz you on this one. How many players on have you got on your team, on the field?
Four.
4v4? Okay, so carry on.
And then, you know, sticking with that guy the whole time. That's, just a little bit more on that.
All right, so we're getting into some serious stuff. We're talking tactics here, okay? Tactics. If I mark a guy, that's a tactic. That's a tactic. You know, in the NCAA basketball that's going on right now, for instance, you see all sorts of styles of defending, don't you? Matchup zones. You'll see somebody who's got a 7 foot forward or center, and you might have a guard who's 5 feet nine. There aren't many left, actually. There's a few. Marquette mostly lost with theirs. That was my last job for 15 years. They did well. They were unlucky. Third round. Pretty good for them. But you have a matchup zone. You have a man for man. You have different styles. Kansas, I guarantee, at some point are going to put three guys across the half line like this, and they're giants. It's a tactic. Send the ball over the top. The other two pick off the ball. It's great. I'm a basketball coach, really. I just made all this soccer stuff up. So here's the recommendation. The tactics at the ages that you coach, particularly, even the 10 to 12, I would tell you, are supposed to be very, very fundamental, low-key. You will invest too much time for too little return. But here's my problem. The more you focus, and I don't want to be rude to you, by the way, but the more you invest in the tactical side of it, the less experience they'll have at playing the game. They will be doing a job which may or may not relate to the game. The worst example, and it's not so much round here, but certainly in Wisconsin where I was. This is November in Wisconsin, and I'm the defender on the right side, and I'm freezing. But I've been told this is my area to stand, and this I get anybody who comes in my area. And I get the ball and I run up and I kick it and then I run back into my area. Anybody ever seen that? Well, we're selling the kids short. And they came to run around. So my balancing act is to say, yeah, we need some organization. But I'll give you a couple of words that I think would be helpful to you. When we have the ball, try and stay connected to each other. Connected. So wouldn't it be a fun if I hold your hand? Mm-mm. All right, I'm holding her hand. We're connected. But I might do some little games with these kids where we actually have two or three people running around doing this. And I'm sure there are games that on these videos there's a game where the coach will call five and everybody's got to rush and get into groups of five or get into groups of two. They've got to rush and get in groups of two. So that's a good warm-up. But it's bonding as well. But the point is we stay connected so that I can pass the ball. You're close enough to receive it. You're close enough to receive it. And everybody says, spread out, we're swarming. But the problem with that is we suddenly are so far apart we can't kick the ball to each other, we just kick it down the field. The other part of it, which I would say is important, is I like my guys, any age, from one up, whatever they start playing at, control the ball, pass, control the ball, pass, control the ball, dribble, move, pass. If you play kickball, people get hit in the face and it's a mess. But by controlling it in any way, suddenly they're all rushing at me and I go, pop, there's my pass. I think you should demand that. Because once you do that, you get soccer as opposed to just, zzz. I always equate it to, you know, in a balloon where you pump it up, blow it up, and then you don't put a knot in the end and you hold it like this and let go. What happens? Goes all over the place and then it's done. Well, that's what the game's a bit like. Everybody swarms over the ball, it goes out of bounds and everybody stops. But everybody's and it's a mess. So I think you can do better. So as far as the defending is concerned, I would not tell them to follow a man, a player, another, you know, one-on-one basketball type defending. I would not do that. I would tell you that last I checked, the goal was in the middle of the field. Think about it. Goal's in the middle. So if my play is way out in the wing, like this, and the goal's way over there, why am I doing this? Mm-hmm. I want to be involved in the game, which involves a ball. So I'd probably come in here to stay connected to my teammates, and then as the ball starts to go, then I might. And once they have the ball, that's man on man, isn't it? I agree with you 100%. But I wouldn't say let's routinely follow that player around. So I'm trying to de-emphasize tactics and positions simply because I like movement. And I think the more we stretch them this way, the other team, and then a little bit this way, the more we can stay connected. 1 to 2 to 3 to 4. Would that make some sense? And then defensively, if the goal is here, it would be logical for us to say the rush, this is the goal. And I'm coming from here. I actually will probably put my body between them. You've got the ball. Put myself between them and the goal first. And then think about this. But if I start like this, chances are if they kick the ball behind me, the fastest runner will win. So if you're quicker than me, you will turn me and I will lose. But by coming in here, you'll come back to me. Because I'm already here. I only ran 2 paces. You've got to run 3 now. But if I run here and try and chase you, you will win. I'm trying to de-emphasize tactics. I'm trying to get them to control, pass, move, dribble. I don't have a priority of which is the most important, because everybody who's a parent on the side is telling you that that kid is a ball hog. And why should they dribble when my kid wants them a pass? Yes? You're smiling because I think you've heard it. But the contradiction is we are trying to give them more and more individual flair, skill, fun, which involves dribbling a ball. So the balance between dribbling and passing has got to be tempered. If only one person shoots and scores all the time, that's going to cause problems. And I empathize with you because parents are tough. I would have a preseason meeting and straighten it all out, though. I would make sure that we're all on the same page. It's good that you have to rotate the players 50% of playing time, which is absolutely your lifesaver. Is it important to win the game?
No.
Okay. How long, if you, just supposing the kids win, how long do they remember it?
Until they get their treats.
That's right.
You must have been with me before. Until they get the treats. Win or lose, it lasts as long as the treats. And the problem is the parents do remember. See where I'm going with all that? Everything falls back on you orchestrating the parents to understand what you're trying to do. I think the simple answer to any question you might offer is, if the kid comes back tomorrow and he's still smiling, you're probably doing a good job. That's it. All right, I'll move on, because otherwise we could get into a philosophical debate. This one is a new one, and I think it's very good. Let them add rules. So we haven't spoken tonight. What's your name?
Mark.
Mark.
Yes.
Okay. So when the ball goes out of bounds, Mark, how are we going to get it back in? Throw, kick, dribble, what we want? What do you want?
Kick.
You want a kick?
Yes.
Hate that answer. So I gave them some ownership. Empowerment, it's called. It's not a bad answer, actually. I could let you do that for a while. What was your name again?
Mark.
Mark. How do you want to restart the game? Give me something different.
Throw in.
Oh. So the worst possible way to restart the game is a throw in. I hate that answer. My phone went again. Apologize for that. A throw in is the worst, because when you throw a ball in, is the ball on the ground or in the air most of the time? Does it bounce a bit? So it's really hard to play with. Now, on last week's course, I did some things how to control that ball and get it down and play. But the problem is, it tends to be a bit of this, doesn't it? See kids? Well, that's no good. By the way, I didn't know I could do that. I like that. So I think I would say I wanted him to be involved in the decision, but I didn't like his decision. So how would you do it? What do you think? What's good?
Kicking.
Kicking? Okay. We tried that one. What else? Give me another one.
Pass it in?
Okay. Give me another one.
Dribble in.
I like that one. You know what? I think we're going to try that one today. So we're going to dribble it in. Well done. Everybody, we're going to dribble it in for a while. Okay. Now, why would I do that? Why is dribbling maybe a good thing?
Control.
Think of the numbers. Okay. We're playing. What's your name, sir?
Pete.
Nice name. I got a brother, Pete. He's a doctor. Are you a doctor? Oh, okay. He's a doctor. Got any child hormone problems? Go to my brother. Big time. Major. Teenage hormone problems? Anybody got any problems? See me. I'll point you to Pete. Okay, so here's the thing. You're playing four a side, you said, right? So somebody is dribbling the ball in. How many players do you have on the field now? You got one off the field with the ball. There's seven on the field, but there's only three of yours, right? Three. How many do they have? Four. Is that more than yours or less than yours? Okay, so you're outnumbered. But we have the ball. We have the ball. And they've got more men on the field. So who are we going to pass to? The other team. Most likely. If we throw it, for sure we got a problem. So do you understand why dribbling is good? Because all of a sudden, we have a chance, if we pass or we dribble, that now the numbers are even again. We've got a chance to keep the ball. All we're saying is, we got the ball, we want to keep the ball, don't we? So that's the point. So empowerment, all I've done is say, let them add rules. I want to get the answer that helps me, but I'm still giving you that. Yeah, good for you. Thinking of a good, I like that.
So are you saying that they get to choose how they...
I'm saying a lot of the time, you'll get a huge pop if you ask them, But you only let them give the answer that you want. If you don't like it, ask it again.
Well, we're talking about practice.
Practice, yeah. But in a game, you're also going to play. You're not going to play throw-ins at U8. You're going to play kick-ins. Why? Because you've got a better chance of keeping the ball down and not getting somebody hurt for a start. Because once it comes in like this, I promise you're going to get loads of kids bashing heads. It happens all the time. And there's all this new concussion stuff that's going on, and they've just passed it in the legislature. Oh, my boss is the one that got it through, by the way. So all good. On the advanced coaching courses, we now have to do a concussion exam. Everybody has to do an exam. All right, provide them with challenges. Don't make it boring. Remember that first thing? Who did the warm-up? The very first? Yeah, you did, Paul, yeah. Was it fun? Do you think they had a blast with it?
No.
I'd be bored. Yeah. Was it fast, slow, empowering, challenging? Was the winners, losers? No, it was just do it, wasn't it? So just doing it's probably not the bestest. Is that a word?
It is now.
It is now, like that. My favorite word's gooder. Okay, so that was when we went into the gates. We had the circle going on. Was that a lot of fun? Was that fairly boring? Did it get more fun as we started to do different colors and different speeds and different directions and change direction? Yeah, it should. So give them challenges in any way, whether there's somebody chasing them, which at your age some kids might not like. Think outside the box, awaken their imagination, but they are kids, they're not mini adults. You coaches, the three C's. The three C's. Comfort zone. I had a coach last week in a session we ran for Olympic development, and he came off and he said, I've just done the best session I've ever done in my life. And I went, I was watching you on the field next to you. That was the most boring session I've ever seen in my life. Everybody did everything perfectly. He never challenged them to the next level. They did work they did when they were 10 years old, and these kids were 15, 16 years of age, and it was so dull they wanted to go home. But he thought it was good because they did it well. So you have to temper well with challenges. So you're at comfort zone, their comfort zone, and obviously you're gauging them. You know your players, so you know what they're able to do. I take them just a fraction further than they're comfortable by just saying, well, can we do it quicker? How hard is that? Can we do it a fraction quicker? Of course we can. Doesn't mean you've got to be successful all the time. It just means you're going to try and go quicker. Because in the game, you're going to have to go quicker. My biggest problem is when people say, do it slowly, and they get in a game, it doesn't work, and they won't ever try it again. Why? Because you let them down. Things we did tonight, we didn't do through the legs. Young kids love the ball through the legs. They love crawling through the legs. I don't know if there's some psychological thing on it. I should take a course on that. Maybe I'd have some better answers. Point being, this, the gates are good. Through the legs is good. Games where they get struck and they don't go out the game, but then you get them back in the game in some way by saying, kneel down on one knee or arm in the air, and they get the ball through your legs and now they can be back in the game. Things like that. I did bring technique into everything we did, even when we were just doing silly things. Techniques became part of it. I love decision making. And I think even at the youngest ages, you make them make minor, small, simple, low-level decisions. Our job is to steer them in a certain direction. And the hardest thing, observe the trends. As you stand there, say, I don't know what's going wrong, but I know something's wrong. So that's the hardest thing, and I accept that for you. But at the end of the day, you will work out what's going wrong because you'll get to know your kids. If they pass the ball to a fellow teammate, then that's positive, and you can then take it to the next level. Can you do it quicker? Can we do a million different things? These are just examples. The only problem with Pac-Man for me is historically Pac-Man, you're out. Who gets out first in a game? The best or the worst kid? The worst kid. Now he's really upset. He knows he's the worst. He gets less playing time, so he just gets worser. When you come from England, you're allowed to use words like that. I also have a degree in English. I don't know how. We did this. We did most of those. I like the stop at the light thing more than anything in that game because it gives them a chance to improve their balance and their coordination and their creativity. You'd be amazed what things kids come up with. And a lot of times they'll make the sound that goes with it. How about boy racer? I didn't see any boy racers on the starting blocks there. Brum, brum, leaving rubber on the road. You're all too grown up. My neighbors will. Here's just a picture of this. This is very similar to the last page again. The only difference is here, it's a little clearer. But I put two flags here because I gave a direction of play. And I think for the eight-year-olds, for sure, I would be putting a... You don't have to score in this. You just have a notion of we're actually playing in these directions, this way and this way, this way and this way, as opposed to just going anywhere. The other thing I've got here, and it is on your sheet, you may not have appreciated yet, and that sheet is actually, you haven't got it printed in color. Mark has it in color, so if he happened to email it to you, you'd see the color coordination, but you can see it on here. I have the blues, and I think on your sheet the blues also are very close together. I have the greens extremely wide. So it could be that if I have a kid who's a little better than the rest and I need to challenge him, I'm going to tell him he can only go through the blue gates. Make sense? How does he feel if you say, here's a little challenge for you, here's a reward for you, good or bad? The parent says, I like the fact that my kid now is being pushed to do something a little harder because he's the best player on the team. He is, of course, the best player. They're all the best player on the team, right? But you've got that one kid. Remember when my boy was eight? We had a scenario where at the end of the season, one kid had never scored. Everybody else had scored. He was a really nice kid. He was a rotten soccer player. They gave him the ball all the time in that last league match to try and get a goal. And he did finally get the goal. It was worth $1 million to that kid. But you don't get eight-year-olds very often they're willing to share like that. But here's the challenge to make everybody a little better and then say, okay, so now then, try the red ones. And maybe what part of the foot you used, or maybe you say it's only the weaker foot. Whatever. I do little things here where I play one-on-one games. Sometimes I widen them wider than this to play one-on-one games, a pass, and then the other one's trying to get to the gate. I do some things where they dribble around here. I put figure of eight on your thing there. You can get to the gate. You can run a figure of eight. So we're actually doing something that improves their balance and their change of direction, things like that. This one is almost taboo these days, just so as you know, going back to that concussion thing. I would warn you against doing a lot of heading, particularly, they're talking about 10 and 11 and 12 years old being the sort of cusp these days for teaching heading. The problem is it occurs in the game sometimes, and you'd like to know that, what part of the head do you use to head the ball most of the time? What's it called? Forehead? Yeah? Forehead? Forehead, yeah. Where's that? Everybody point to it. Okay. Let me tell you this. The more you say that to the players, the more it hits them in the face or on the top of the head. Because they don't move their feet, but they try and do something to get their forehead on the ball. And so they do this. Whack. So there is a problem with it. I would tell you that this game, and a guy called Robin Pike, who's a buddy of mine from England, is the one that came up with this game. Robin Pike has never played soccer in his life. He weighs 100 pounds too much. He is the best soccer coach I've ever seen in my life, but he's a player who's a person who's never, ever played the game. He just happens to be a brilliant man. He's a Chelsea fan, so he's probably very happy today. for anybody who didn't spoil it for anybody, I hope. Point being, we're kneeling down, and it's an underhand feed, and it goes through my legs. And you can, has anybody got a ball in here, just out of interest? Because I could demonstrate. Mark, have you got a ball anywhere? Just a very quick thing. Can I, who wants to volunteer? You just did. You moved. Good. That's great. Could you come here? So, just so everybody can see, kneel down. Just get your hands back on your heels, your haunches there. Stick your chest out. That's it. That's it. Good. So, here's the interesting thing. Would you do me a flavor now? Just rock onto a push-up position. And now do, no. Just keep your knees down. The other push-up position. That's it. So, this time, do that again. But keep looking at the ball. Keep looking at the ball as you do it. Very good. All right, so just turn a slight angle just so we can do this. All you got to do, now get back a little bit there, just rock into it and head the ball back to me. Good job. Get it through my legs. Good job. So he gets it through my legs. And I can cheat any way I like. I've got one more version. You got one? Can you do one more?
Sure.
Good lad. Success, right? Then start to reward them for not touching it. But that is the perfect pose because you can only use your forehead. So I don't use the word forehead. I don't use anything. I just say, head this back. And then we have a third person there. We rotate. You get up, go to there. The next person, as the ball moves forwards, I get down. And they go, oh, boom, and off we go again, yeah? Game. Thank you. Good. So there's level one. Level two is we stand up and head it over their head. We say, get it over there. So you throw it there and they go. Because now they know. And then we rotate and then, yeah, it's good. First to 10. Wow, kids will do it forever. So I do this with kids and I have admit to doing it to with 8-year-olds, but I like a ball that's got a softer cover, not necessarily, this is flat and it sponges on your face, doesn't it? In my case, no problem. I ain't got no nose end. No problem at all. Snip, snip. Hold that. Good job. Okay. That's it, I think, on that one. Any questions on that? Okay, one more quick one. I have to admit that I'm not going to go into... two more quick ones. This one is really, really quick. They have things here, psychology and all that stuff, socio-psycho, whatever it's called these days, and characteristics of the kids. And some of this stuff is online, and I can supply to any of you any of this information. This... stick here has over 1,200 files in it, all soccer practices. It's quite, you build it up over time. Those numbers are interesting. Our problem is at 13, everybody quits, and it's our fault. So we have to make it fun because our job is to make them play for the long haul. Simple to complex decision-making implications in the real game. Elimination of lines. Elimination is an L also. Elimination games, lines, laps, lectures. We don't use the word drill very often. Drill is a traditional term. What is the difference between a drill and an activity? Can anybody give me some sort of general difference? If we're doing a warm-up in basketball, which most of us will know, give me a warm-up that you might do in basketball.
Layup drill.
Huh?
Layup drill. A layup drill.
The problem, the only difference with that is it is the same. Everything goes, you go here, you rebound, switch lines, maybe a pass, but there is an end product, which is a goal, the basket. How about we run to a spot, we receive a ball, we pivot, we play, and we move somewhere else? What about we run to a line and we turn around and come back? Maybe we dribble to a line and come back. Yes? Those are drills. When you put an end product in there, which is to say a goal, a line, or something, it becomes an activity. If I told you that today's practice in soccer, we're going to get the ball, dribble to that line there, and come back for the next 10 minutes, will you be excited? Rote learning, repetitive, is not. That's a drill. Even if you say, can you go faster? Can you do it in less touches? Can you change feet and do it? It's still not sick. Can we find a way that makes it more like a game and makes it more fun? So all we're saying is, can we introduce the concept of fun into it? And that's what that's about. Six-year-olds, as I mentioned outside, one ball each. As much as you might like to make them do 1 to 2, 1 to 4, it's not their nature. Their nature is that's as far as they can think. Even with some inner-city kids in bad cities, Birmingham, Alabama as an example, I did a clinic there with some 16 to 18-year-olds. Everybody got a ball at the start. We tried to leave the balls while they rotated. They would not leave their ball. That's my ball. Why? Because they had nothing in life. One kid had to be removed because he refused to give it up. And his coordinator was, he had the ball, and my coordinator's doing this, trying to pull it away from him. One had feet in the air like this. I will not let go of that ball. That's my ball now, he said. So young kids don't expect miracles because that's what they are. Eight-year-olds, one ball to two people, they will begin to pass the ball. All this stuff here, the balloon thing comes in again. A lot of activity. Water. Boom. Older kids, not the same. Recognize that that's a consideration. Now we get to 1 to 4. I'm not sure about this physical strength thing. I just haven't seen that in most 10-year-olds. They're still kids. They ain't got a lot of muscle. Now the girls are starting to change a little bit before the boys. You get to here, the problem with this is if it's 1 to 8, you only get a touch 1 in every 8 times if you're all as good as one another. Do you always have 8 equally good players? So the same kids get a lot of touches and the other ones get no touches, so that's a huge problem. That's from a handbook. It's a game played by children. I'm going to finish. I got a lot of these, and I'm not going to have time to go through all of them. One of them has got questions. I'll pull one slide from one more. Only because I think it's an absolutely fabulous, maybe it's 2 or 3 slides. Just ask yourself those questions. I hope this is set up correctly. Let's see. Can you read the last two bits? Shame. The last word is the biggest problem. This concept for most people will come from you and your attitude. These are the reasons they came. These are the things that they'll grow. And does anybody know at what age people, this is not me talking, this is me quoting, at what age do players become so-called competitive? Anybody got an idea of an age? Huh? 12? Truly competitive, that goes beyond the snacks. 12 to 14 is considered the starting point. So in other words, as much as you think competitive and teaching them how to win and all that, they're not ready for it. I'm sorry. I don't make this stuff up. I'm just the deliverer of the message. But you'll find that there are people who love to play. And the thing that will drive you nuts is they don't care about these two things either. So what I'm asking you is to weigh them up and balance. It's lovely to win. If you prepare your team better than your opponent, you will, by extension, you will win more times than you lose. You will win more than your opponents because the winning is the extension of the work you've put in. So give them the tools, give them the love, the passion, the enthusiasm. Good things will happen. But all I'm saying here is this will keep them coming back, and that's our real job. We have 80% of our kids quit at 13 in this state. Now, it's not that you quit soccer, they quit all sport. Now, do you want your teenage children to never do anything active? Be honest with me. It's fair to say you'd like them to get out of the house, something, do something. Socializing comes out of playing sport. Challenging yourself to do something better. Health and fitness come out of it. These are all good qualities. Unfortunately, it's your job now. And we thank you for it. Thanks for your attention. Thanks for your time. You've been great. Good luck with your seasons. Carry on.